Good morning. Welcome to the first Sunday of the Christmas season. Some folks like to wait to sing Christmas carols Christmas Eve, and then in the few weeks following, we go all out a little bit earlier, and I'm happy to be a part of that, but I also love to do it, as is tradition, following Christmas. Next Sunday, the 5th, moves us not only into January, but gets us headed toward what is called Epiphany, and that is technically on the 6th, but on the 5th, the church calendar starts to mark the story following the birth of Jesus. So that's when there's an emphasis on the three kings and so forth next Sunday. But today we just pause and celebrate the good news of the Christ coming to us. Hope you'll say hi to someone who might be visiting and in town this morning. We do have the coffee and fellowship following worship, so please stay. There's a lot of good things there that folks hustle to bring around for us, so I appreciate them. I've got a couple of announcements. The service at the Timbers, the retirement community and assisted living center, it will take place today at 2:30, and I'll be there a few minutes early, and we will probably emphasize some Christmas carols during that time too, but I'll have some scripture, and anyone who comes is welcome to help. I know there's a good team that assists with that, so I'll see you out there a little before 2:30 today. And then I'll mention the sermon series that I've suggested and will lead during January and February on Christian holiness. I know that this is an emphasis that's been important to me in my life and ministry, and I don't want to come at it in ways that are too familiar or get old, but I think we can dig in with some depth and see what it means for our lives and how God calls us to live, and we'll do that up to Lent. So that'll be January and February with a flyer and more word about that to come. Say a word about church office this week in this kind of unusual calendar year with the two holidays landing in the middle of the week. It throws things off a little bit, of course, even as we celebrate the holidays. But I've had a few days of time with family, and I've been grateful for that. I'll be hustling with you and for you today and in touch with some people later, as well as the worship service at Timbers. And then I'll take some more time this week to be with the family. And the office will be closed until Thursday, correct, Becky? Thursday. Becky will be in 9 to noon, I believe, on Thursday. And, of course, she and I will be sharing information for the bulletin next week before then and everything. But I will be around town if you need me for an emergency. If it's a detail that might wait till next week, that might be better. But if it's an emergency, I'm here to help and serve you. Finally, I want to say thank you. And I feel really inadequate to the task. And this is for the love gift that y'all shared with me, with Liz, with Velma, Christmas Eve. I got home from the service and, you know, loosened the tie and sat down on the couch with the family and opened the card and about fell down on the floor because of the power of that in your generosity. And pastors probably exaggerate things sometimes when they're trying to either be nice or what have you. But the fact of the matter is, I've never received that kind of generosity in 33 years of ministry. I mean, that was like, for me, that was something else. I was like awestruck and very much grateful for that and hope I can convey it in more adequate ways. I feel like I'm not equal to that, but really grateful. Let's see, where's Mr. Butts go? I've got a card for you on behalf of the congregation, and if you don't mind receiving it from us, Barb Groner is the chair of this. Thank you. Right. Thank you. Barb Groner is the chair of the Staff Parish Relations Committee, which is a committee that helps the pastor and staff relate to the whole congregation, and she's not here today. So, and Frank was the person who has asked to share the gift with me Christmas Eve. So he is the chair of our board, or ad council, as we say. So I'll share that. It's all too modest for me, but you folks knocked me out. So, okay. I invite us to stand and share the peace of Christ. And then, Kathy, I believe you'll be calling us together after the peace. And then Gloria will be helping us as well with the readings today.
Please remain standing or stand as you are able for the call to worship. Christ is born. Give him glory. Receive him. Christ is now on earth. Exalt him. O you earth, sing to the Lord. O nations, praise him in joy. For he has been glorified. Our opening hymn, Angels We Have Heard on High, is number 238, or it will be on the wall.
Angels, we have heard on high.
Good. Today we have the privilege of celebrating the service of nine lessons and carols. This is a service that has been adapted for a little over 100 years, I'll put it that way, and it is expressed in different ways in different church settings, either during Advent, leading up to Christmas, sometimes Christmas Eve, and oftentimes in the Sunday of Christmas, following Christmas celebration. There's a history to this service that is powerful. It comes out of the English tradition of Christianity, particularly the Anglican tradition. And I'll share some things that I've learned about it over the years. In 1880, E.W. Benson, who was then the Anglican Bishop of Truro, England, composed a festival of nine lessons and carols based on ancient sources and, of course, the scriptures for Christmas Eve. In 1918, following the experience of World War I, the English leader of King's College, Cambridge University in England, Dean Eric Milner White, composed a service of nine lessons and carols that, in my way of saying, reminded the world that there is great hope that comes out of tragedy following the death and the destruction of World War I. And it was a celebration of new life. And on Christmas Eve 1918, the service that we know now as the Service of Lessons and Carols from King's College at Cambridge was celebrated. Dean White used this language. He talked about the theme, and he said in these words that have always stayed with me, quote, "The development of the loving purposes of God is the major theme, as seen through the windows and words of the Bible." So this is a powerful tradition that is just a little over 100 years old in its current form, reminding the world that following great tragedy, despair, death, and destruction, there is the promise of life.
Our first lesson is from the book of Genesis, chapter 3, verses 8 through 15 and 17 through 19. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." And to the man he said, "Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree about which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life, thorns and thistles that shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Our next carol is Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, verse 1, and it's number 196.
Our second lesson is from Genesis chapter 22, verses 15 through 18. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you. And I will make your offspring as numerous as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of their enemies. And by your offspring shall all the nations of the earth gain blessing for themselves because you have obeyed my voice." Our second carol is O Come Emmanuel, verses 1 and 7. This is number 211 in the hymnal or on the wall.
The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
Micah 5, verses 2 through 5. But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, you are one of the little clans of Judah. From you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel, and he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace. If the Assyrians come into our land and tread upon our soil, we will raise against them seven shepherds and eight installed as rulers. O little town of Bethlehem, verses 1 through 1 and 4.
Our next lesson comes from Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 35 and verse 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I'm a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. Our next carol, "Joy to the World," verses 3 and 4.
Luke 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
Chapter 2, verses 8 through 16. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. The carol is number 229.
Our next lesson comes from the second chapter of Matthew, verses 1 through 11. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all of Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod secretly called the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child, and when you've found him, bring me word so that I may go and pay him homage.' When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh."
Thank you.
John 1, verses 1 through 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all people might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as a Father's only Son, full of truth and grace. Seated. That story never gets old. Invite us to be aware of folks who are in need this season, and take note, of course, of those listed in the back of the bulletin. I know that's not exhaustive of folks who need our prayer. I do have a couple of prayer needs that have developed more recently. First of all, we're happy that Louis Hoyt has been able, Louis, where'd you go? I got looking past you. Yeah, feeling a bit better after some problems with an illness with his kidneys, and yet some follow-up tests, too, that I know you have to have. So we want to be in prayer for you with that as well. And then Doris has mentioned that I want to make sure Mac, is it Velthaus, okay. Max Velthaus was in a car accident on Christmas Day. So we want to keep him in prayers. Hope that he's going to be okay. And okay, all right. Gloria Staten had nephew, and Gloria, I wanted to make sure, Barry Ayers? Okay. Barry is quite seriously ill with a brain aneurysm, and he's in intensive care, and surgery is planned for noon today. So very serious situation that needs intervention today. So we want to keep Barry in our prayers. He has some children, three boys that are middle school, high school age. So family going through a very tough time. Now, Joanne Barnhart has shared some bad news that John is under the weather. He has shingles and some other things, and so he's feeling low and lying low, but needing our prayer and support, as well as she needs our prayer and support, so we hope he gets better. And Marsha Butts' brother-in-law. And Marsha, remind me of his name. Vern. His part of a lung removed for his illness. He's been ill for some time and waiting for some things to sort of line up medically so that he could be treated, and now it's about to take place, right? Yeah, Tuesday, okay. So we want to keep Vern in our prayers as well. I invite us to go to the Lord in prayer, and following the time of spoken prayer, I'll pause for silent prayer, and then we'll close with our Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. O God on high, who bent low, we come to you with joy and thanksgiving, and yes, Lord, continued heaviness here and there. We pause to give thanks in the midst of the ups and downs of life and ask that you be with those listed, those named, those held in our hearts. Be with those in places near and far, Lord, who experience war and famine, disease, and yes, the inhumanity of humanity. Guide us, lift us, move us to drink from the well of your love so that we may share that with each and every person. We bring all of this before you, Lord, in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Comes the time to give back a portion of what the Lord has given us. Will the ushers come forward for our morning offering? Dear God and Father of Jesus Christ, we praise you with joyful songs. We're glad to celebrate the birth of your only Son, Jesus. His life is the light of all people. Thank you for opening our eyes to recognize him as our Savior. May our lives and ministries embody Christ's grace and truth so that our neighbors will find new life in relationship with you. We return a portion of your goodness to us in these tithes and offerings. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now, if you'll circle up, we'll sing our closing hymn, Let There Be Peace on Earth.
Take the light of Christ with you into the world. The world sure needs it. And may the peace of Christ fill you with such overflowing love that you can do nothing less than love others. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.